This is New York City. It's home to over 8.5 million people, which are crammed in at a rate of about 26,000 people per square mile. The sheer amount of people and its location make New York one of the most expensive places in the world to buy a house, which is why only a third of people do it. But if you go across the world to a place just like it, that number changes from 33% in New York to an astronomical 90% in Singapore. On an island so small it makes Japan look obese, you'd think buying a house would be practically impossible, from the lack of land and high density. But with some hefty government purchasing power, they did the impossible. In the 1960s, just before it became the first country to gain independence against its will, this is what the streets of Singapore looked like. With a GDP per capita of just over $400, the nation was struggling to hold on, as 30% of the population was living in urban slums. People stored their waste in buckets inside their houses, which often quickly transferred pathogens throughout tightly packed villages.
Tuberculosis has been dramatically reduced in Singapore, but it is still at its highest in the slum areas. Sanitation is at a minimum, so refuse is dumped in the streets.
Additionally, each shack had about 11 families living inside of it, and villages had hundreds of shacks. Most shacks were made of wood and other highly flammable materials, allowing one spark to take down an entire village since the houses were so close. All of this made living a constant struggle, but the young government had a plan. They wanted to get all of these people out of the dirty camps. Initially, people didn't want to leave their way of life, but when a fire in Bukit Ho Swee destroyed 2,800 houses and left tens of thousands homeless, it was either a new house from the government or a bed made of ash. So as comfy as ash sounds, most people took the new house.
Soon all Singapore's people will be housed in modern blocks like these, and the danger of such devastating fires will be gone forever.
As they came in, people were seen bringing their farm animals up the stairs and even keeping chickens in the middle of their government-sponsored apartments, to I'm sure the delight of their neighbors. To bring people these new homes, Singapore created the Housing Development Board, or HDB, and within its first 5 years, it built over 50,000 new homes, mostly in apartment buildings. This was a huge number compared to the only 21,000 made in the 32 years leading up to that. This feat was of course no easy task, and it led to a bunch of leaking ceilings and creaky floors due to low quality rapid work. But after quality was increased and problems were fixed, it showed a future of possibility, but also control. In the United States, this is what most public housing looks like. Known as housing projects, these areas often have much higher than average rates of extreme poverty, crime, and drug use. This is because housing is only given to the absolute poorest people in America, which is why they're only used by less than 1% of the total population, and often create racial and social enclaves. If you go to the UK, they have higher standards in their public housing option, but still only 17% of people live in them, leaving many people without help. Seeing this, Singapore knew what its housing mustn't become. As British military forces left Singapore, its Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew knew people needed something to rally around. If they were going to send their kids off to the army, they should at least know what they're fighting for. So he decided to make that thing their house. If everyone had a house, or at least an apartment they owned, they'd have roots in the country and would be more likely to stay and be devoted to its success. But people at the time could barely buy a few bricks, let alone an entire house. So the government devised a plan. They attracted companies from around the world with low taxes and little regulation to give people good jobs. Then, to ensure people would make good use of their money, they forced everyone to pay 20% of their income, and the company they worked for paid 17%, which all went into a retirement account, part of which could be used to pay for the new housing. Then, most importantly, the government made an insane amount of houses that they could sell for subsidized prices. This mixture of new jobs and new buildings made for all types of incomes led the amount of people in public housing to skyrocket, from 9% in 1960 to 81% today. But there are a few catches. Although Singapore claims that 90% of people own their house, the 4.5 million people who live in government housing are only getting a really long lease, 99 years to be exact. This is obviously longer than the average person's life, so most just consider it to be buying the house. But it makes it impossible for people to move the house down from generation to generation, as the government always owns the deed and the property itself. Singapore thinks that's not such a bad thing, as it motivates people to work for themselves and allows for old buildings to be replaced by newer and shinier ones. This, along with government-sponsored HGTV home improvements after 30 and 60 years, leads housing prices to almost never lose value. But some argue this is pricing out the young, who can't afford nicer and more expensive places, and it also doesn't give true ownership. But even with this upkeep, Singapore's public housing is still 20% cheaper than equivalent private housing, drawing huge amounts of people to live in public housing rather than private. These benefits aren't for everyone, though. If you make more than 1,500 Singaporean dollars a month, your only option is to buy a 99-year lease in public housing, or rent a much more expensive flat from the private market, even if you can't afford it. This is because the government only lets the absolute poorest people rent apartments for a few years at a time, while everyone else is pushed to buy. Singapore also controls exactly who can get a house. Like if you're not married or are a same-sex couple, the government will literally not let you buy a house from them until your 35th birthday. And if you're a foreigner, the only option is private housing with an additional 20% tax on top. All of this is because Singapore wants to support the people that will support them back. If you're single, it's pretty unlikely you're gonna have a kid, so Singapore, with its declining birth rate, wants to have the best odds that a future worker might be created by giving couples the security of a house they kinda own. Plus, if you're paying a bunch of money in taxes, they want to get you some benefits. Then, for people eligible to get a house, Singapore controls where they can live, by limiting races like Chinese and Malaysians to only occupy the same percent of housing blocks as they do on average across the entire country. This prevents racial enclaves from being created, which often lead to interracial clashes and hate, something familiar from the early days of Singapore's founding when it had two race riots in the span of just a few years. But this policy can also block certain groups of people from getting the house they want. For example, if a Chinese family wants to get a house in a certain apartment complex, but all of the openings are being sold by Malaysians, they'll either have to wait until a Chinese flat goes up for sale, or they'll have to go somewhere else. But for most, these regulations allow for public housing to have barely any stigma and to create peaceful and planned communities with everything you could ever ask for. This group of public housing has basketball courts, a playground, restaurants, rooftop garden, yoga studio, school, police station, and daycare center, all basically right on top of it. Oh yeah, also the building looks pretty cool, and these things aren't anything unusual. It's a bit different from other public housing from around the world. Housing blocks in Singapore are sources of the most cutting-edge architecture and design in the world, as they account for how to maximize breeze to reduce air conditioning costs, use solar panels to harness energy from the sun, or even have rooftop gardens and integrated nature just to keep people happy. But this seeming utopia might come with some unintended side effects. Hey guys, I love making these videos, but they take a ton of time from researching, writing, recording, and editing. So if you want to see more videos like this, please consider subscribing. And I'll see you next time here on SparkFest.